Strategic Hot Box with Dr. Brandi Love Stankovic. Discussing leadership, business, and how to take control of your life and achieve greatness. From the streets of Las Vegas, energized, informed, and never diluted, it's time to kick some ass.
Hey, it's your girl, Dr. Brandi Stankovic, and we're here for another episode of the Strategic Hot Box. So welcome back. Today's episode is all about agile, mind over method, and what that means. And actually, I have no idea what it means. To be completely honest, I still don't know what it means. But the good news is, here today, we have Amber Harsin with us, and she is hopefully going to fill our brains with knowledge and truly explain to us the power of agile and impact it has on business. So welcome to Amber. And we'll get to know her a little bit more as we go forth. So let's get started. As you guys know, here on the Strategic Hot Box, we break things down into learn, the love, and the kick ass. And I love to have those ways to phrase it, because in the learn section, we learn something new, a fresh way of thinking about something, a new aha moment, or a thing that can hopefully give us the chills, an idea, a fresh, you know, kind of perspective. And then in the love section, we talk about relationships, we talk to subject matter experts, we talk to people that know more than me, and that's a lot of people. That's most people. And then in the kick-ass, I want to leave you with some tools to make a difference. How can you start executing and doing something differently today? And really, it's all about having authentic discussions. So since we began this journey of the Strategic Hot Box, and it's been a year already, which blows my mind, that over the course of time, I have learned so many amazing things. I've met so many amazing people. But in the process of this, it's really the most valuable takeaway for me has been the idea of having real, authentic conversations, having conversations that we have over a drink at the bar, and having conversations that you have away from the boardroom, where you're really digging in and saying, how do we make a difference in people's lives? Or how do we really do something about this? Or what's the bullshit that happened at the office today? And what do we do about it? And we don't often get to have the chance to have those conversations in real time in the office. And that's one of the powers of agile. That's one of the powers of this mindset that we're going to learn about today from Amber. And I think that the Strategic Hot Box is a perfect place to highlight some of that. So in preparation for today's podcast, I went out and did a bunch of research, as I always do. I like to try to at least sound smart or sound informed. You know, sometimes it's harder than other times. But nonetheless, I read a bunch of articles, and I've had conversations with Amber, and I've had conversations with Tony, so a colleague that we both work with. And I literally, after reading all those articles, I sat back in my chair and went, what the f... I probably know less about agile now than I did before I started that research. And so then I said, okay, let's take it back to the basics. What's the definition of agile? And that means, from a general sense, it's being able to move quickly and easily. So being nimble, right? So thinking about the football player with the fancy feet, or any sort of sport player. And we also learned from Dr. Kat on a previous podcast that being agile is being like flexible and being able and ready for anything, and being able to work with whoever that you're with in a relationship or sex standpoint, as she was sharing with us. And from an innovation or software or hardware cloud environment, which Amber is going to share, and where it's commonly implemented today, it's characterized by this division of tasks into shorter phrases. Or phases, excuse me. And there's a frequent reassessment and adaptation of the plans. See, even that sentence is so complex. Let me read that again. So, characterized by a division of tasks, so into short little phases. And there's a frequent reassessment. So you're constantly going back and saying, okay, how can we reassess this and adapt and change and change things up? And so agile really then is a mindset. It's not necessarily methodology. And that was an interesting moment for me to say, okay, this isn't something that I could just read a book and implement, right? This is a changing the way that you look at business or look at your processes in your business. And so what I thought I would do is frame the discussion, and then we'll turn over to Amber and we'll hear how we implement. So one of the most important things that's happening in business, and I know that those of you that are listening and watching can relate to this, is that consumer demand is so great right now for speed. Everything needs to happen now. There's all this urgency, and all of us want things immediately. Even Amazon is looking into drones dropping off packages because we need things yesterday. And Amazon Prime in 2 days, we just want to have things just tomorrow. And there's just this demand for having things fixed immediately. Think about this next generation that's growing up with zero patience, right? And we really, that is just, it's living and breathing in customer service, in our client expectations, and in our day-to-day lives. Another thing that's occurring in this world of urgency and consumer demand is that employees are massively distracted and so less engaged in what they're doing. And so a lot of organizations will come to me and say, how do we motivate our employees, or how do we engage our employees? And so that becomes part of a challenge that a lot of organizations face. So we see consumer, you know, urgency, we see employee engagement needs. Another kind of environmental piece is that there's so many regulations, and the political environment is uneasy, unbalanced, you know, a little off kilter right now, I mean, to say fairly. And we don't know exactly where the political environment is going or the regulatory environment is going, but there are always new things coming down the pipeline. And so how do we create efficiencies? How do we, create new cost controls, but also make sure that we're adapting to any new changes that happen to the regulatory environment and be flexible? Because at the end of the day, life happens, right? Shit happens. Poop happens. It just, things happen in life. And anybody that has ever lived, really, I was going to say had kids or had a job, but really, if anybody's ever lived, then you know things change, and they change constantly. And so being able to have a manner at which you approach business, it would, you know, to be able to be nimble and think on your feet is a very powerful way to approach that. So I'd like to, without further ado, bring in the subject matter expert here and introduce Amber Harsin. You are the Director of Product Management at CU Prodigy, and you've got your bachelor's in technical sales management from WGU. You're advisor at the Clinton City Youth Council as well, and you're certified Scrum product owner, which I'm going to need to know what Scrum is. And you're a Scrum master. So at least you have a, you know, like a Scrum black belt. You can like kiss your biceps and be like, Scrum, right?
That's right.
And so Prodigy, tell us a little bit about what Prodigy does, sure. And then we'll dive into some Agile as well.
Yeah. So what CU Prodigy does, we are a credit union service organization, or CUSO, for those of you who maybe know the credit union world a little bit. We are a core provider. So the software that your credit union runs on, you know, that's what our developers are building every day. That's what's being implemented and pushed out. And we do it in a slightly different environment because we are run more like a cooperative. Mm-hmm. So we are owned by our credit unions and have a lot of impact from our credit unions and voice in the direction of the company itself. That's really what we're here to do. Let's collaborate with that particular industry. We're passionate about that industry. And we want to make it better. We're all a lot of credit union lifers, as we like to refer to us. And we want to make sure that we deliver technology that allows that industry to really grow and adapt and compete mm-hmm. in what is really a vicious financial market with banks, fintechs, et cetera.
So if anybody's not in credit unions, financial services in general run on a lot of technology, obviously.
Yes.
And people want access to their money all the time. Mm-hmm. And so when you say that you're core, you offer core technology, mm-hmm. it's the technology that the entire financial institution runs off of.
Correct.
So all the member customer information
yes.
is within that technology.
Yep. Your debit card clearing, your direct deposit hitting, all of that.
My cashola.
Yeah.
So if I want to make it rain later,
yeah,
I could never
you
do
that.
I could never do that. I really, it'd be dollar bills, y'all.
Yeah,
I mean, whatever.
Okay. Right. I'm with you on
that. So all of that runs off this core technology.
Yes.
So then then the demand by consumers for greatness mm-hmm. within that is really strong. And so being run by a cooperative,
correct.
You have a lot of voices to be the best that you can be.
We do. And that's really the goal is the collective brain is always going to be bigger than one or two brains. Oops, mm-hmm. sorry, these are falling off there. And that's really, we'll get into that a little bit as we're talking about Agile, because that's a big principle in Agile is that collaboration and the greater good, always being able to come up with a better solution than a silo of, you know,
so people. A synergy in a sense.
Correct.
Excellent. So what is Agile then?
All right. So let's get into it. As you kind of mentioned in your intro, it's sort of big and
it
a little bit ambiguous.
Mm-hmm.
But it really is a mindset. You hit on that perfectly, that it's not really a thing that you do. Like, you don't go out and you don't do Agile. You have to be Agile. And so it's really a philosophy that was developed out of the software and tech space, known for delivering quick, fast, innovative, you know, products to market. And where what it's really focusing on is the people part. Mm-hmm. Of business.
Sure.
So, you know, they place a lot of value in Agile on collaboration, mm-hmm. open communication, transparency, mm-hmm. social accountability, a lot of introspection and reflection on how are you interacting with your client? How, you know, down to the most minute process, does this work? Should we start, stop, or continue with what we're doing? Mm-hmm. And doing that constantly and not being afraid to fail fast.
Sure.
That's really what Agile is trying to get people to think about. Is it more important to spend all of your time negotiating a contract with your client, or is it more important to be collaborating with that client, building that relationship, and then working on those details, you know, after the fact? Is it more important to make sure that you're spending all of your time making sure tools work? Mm-hmm. Or are you spending that time focusing on what part of that tool is really helping your business move to the next step? Or is it not, and get rid of it?
Sure.
So it's really more of how you approach work uh-huh. in terms of that philosophy than a set of check boxes that you're like, okay, well, today I did this step and I did this step and I did this step. So that means I'm being agile. Now, it's really about framing how you look at everything to constantly be aware mm-hmm. and in the space of what you're doing and making educated decisions collaboratively in a group and making right. sure that you're disseminating that information.
So it's not just internal dialogue then, it's no. dialogue with the clients and customers as well.
Exactly.
Interesting.
It's okay. Got to go both ways or it will not work.
So my initial reaction to this, and I'm sure you've gotten it from customers or members or people that are new mm-hmm. to the frame, is eek. That seems like it. You can't create any economies of scale if you don't create some sort of hard-pressed policy that we do it this way every time.
No, there are frameworks that have been developed out of Agile, and you touched on those with Scrum, mm-hmm. which is a framework we can spend some time with today, that help you sort of guide that process of being Agile, and it really reinforces some of the behaviors. Mm-hmm. But Agile in itself is the behavior.
I get
you know,
it. Okay.
You value your communication, you value your interactions, you value the reflection, you value being nimble, being willing and able to mm-hmm. let go of a plan if it's not working. And reassessing. Scrum lets you do that by kind of giving you a bit
process,
more of a
uh-huh.
framework
uh-huh.
and process to sort of work around uh-huh. and get to that point where you're just doing it inherently and culturally within your organization. So when you talk
about- Do some people freak out in that environment?
Yes, it's not
sure.
for everyone.
Right, is it chaotic?
No, so when you read about Agile and Scrum and you Google it, it sounds like it might be a little chaotic. Mm-hmm. I think my first introduction, you mentioned Tony in your intro, who's mm-hmm. who's my CEO and a colleague of yours. When he first brought it in, a lot of us said, this sounds like we're going to spend so much time in meetings, not getting anything done
right,
and it's
yeah.
sort of just going to be like running from one meeting to another
discussion
or chaos
mm-hmm.
or one discussion. And that's sort of what I expected
right.
when I walked into it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not been the case at all. For us, we're far more efficient today than we were 2 years ago, even with putting that into place. So when it does sound like a lot to implement and
sure.
look at and sounds kind of crazy when you read it, you just don't know,
right.
understand how it's going to work. But once you actually get into the trenches and you start, you know, having in Scrum, there's what's called a daily stand-up. It's a 15-minute check-in every day.
Mm-hmm.
What did I do yesterday? What do I plan to get done today? And do I have roadblocks to accomplishing that? And
mm-hmm.
how can I help anyone else on my team?
So that's something easy that people could implement today. So
Absolutely.
In the morning, having a 15-minute stand-up meeting, mm-hmm. not making it too formal and mm-hmm. just saying, what do we have to accomplish today? What's getting in my way?
Yep.
And go after it.
Yep.
I love that.
Yeah. And so it really allows us
to do Prodigy on 3, 1, 2.
We do all kinds of stuff.
Nice.
You want to know. There's dart games and
yeah. dance parties.
Crazy. Yeah.
Ooh,
we've got some dance
I like
parties.
Dance parties.
You got to keep it fun. Keep people engaged and happy. But what I found instead of the chaos that I kind of expected that to bring in or the ambiguity, mm-hmm. which is what I had read in my research about Agile before we implemented it, was instead it actually brought us into a more cohesive group. So every morning I knew exactly where every single person in my organization
was on their
where were they in their processes? What
it's
were
really
they working
smart.
On? What did they need help with? Was there knowledge that I could share with them to remove a roadblock? Vice versa for them to me. And right. so I'm today more informed about the status of my organization than I've ever been in my adult career.
That's
with,
smart.
With any company. And so, although it sounds crazy,
it's complex. And I think that really we need an agile guru that walks around and makes the lessons so simple, like the Gandhi of agile, that just is like, these are the lessons of agile, because it really, the online just doesn't do it the justice that it deserves. No. But I think I love the idea of keeping abreast, because I mean, so often I'll go to the team like, what are you working on? Mm-hmm. Like, and how can I help you? Or what can we do together? Or whatever. Mm-hmm. We have those conversations a lot. So clearly I need some agile in my life.
It really is great. I mean, there's multiple exercises that you do in Scrum that, again, help reinforce that agile philosophy of collaboration, communication, social accountability, nimbleness, you know, fail fast. All those mm-hmm. things are really reinforced by a lot of what in Scrum is called a ceremony. So if you go out Google Scrum, you're going to see that word. In terms of that 15-minute stand-up, retrospectives,
sure.
where from the smallest item to the largest travesty that you've had in your organization, you really
right.
post-mortem that.
Yep.
You know, what did we do right? What did we do wrong? And what are we going to do next time?
Right.
They're just really important things that have allowed us at CU Prodigy to really transform our company, our
right.
culture, our bottom line mm-hmm. In 24 months, implementing agile, well, adopting an agile mindset, because you don't really implement agile,
right. yeah.
but adopting the agile mindset, implementing Scrum to help us
get
keep
that.
Focused on that mindset,
mm-hmm.
you know, has allowed us to take a company and turn it around and grow 200% in 24 months
yeah.
with fewer people than we started with.
Yes.
So for us, it's been the best thing I think we could have done internally.
That's amazing. And I love the idea of fail faster. We have that at the Strategic Hot Box mm-hmm. at Mitchell Stankovic & Associates. And I was actually talking to one of the colleagues yesterday about that very fact about failing faster. And we do fail as fast as possible.
Yep.
If you screw up, just get up, because we can't fix it until you get up. And we try our best not to be emotional in those moments of, even with my kids, they're crying. I'm like, okay, stop with the crying, because crying has never gotten us,
anyway.
You know, like, just chill out. And then what can I help you with? Or what mm-hmm. can we, you know, do we need Band-Aids? Do we need hospital? Do we need to just stop crying? Or, you know, what do we need to do? And from a work standpoint, the faster we can fail, the faster we can get over it.
Yep.
And my favorite was the best response I think I've ever gotten. She's like, I get it. Don't whine and moan or whatever. Like, let's move on together, which is like the best, like I said, the best response ever. But it is important to do that, because the faster you fail, then the faster you can retrospect, the faster that you can mm-hmm. fix it, the faster you can get to a solution and move towards a better result. So what has been an unexpected learning from the journey?
So when I learned about Agile and Scrum, which is about 2 years ago now, I had never heard the terms before. I've spent 20 years working in financial and healthcare industries, and they were two words. I'm like, Agile means that I'm like bendy in mm-hmm, gymnastics, mm-hmm. right? Like, where I can go real fast. And diving into it, I thought, okay, it works for software. This is built by tech, you know, makes sense. We're a tech company. All right, we're going to give this a shot. And as I dug in and started learning and getting certified and really working with Tony, who is an Agile professional, and learning more about it, what I found myself doing was sitting back and saying, oh my hell, where was this in my credit
right.
union life?
Where have you been all my life?
Yes, it was like my long lost soulmate found me finally. And thinking like, this would have killed in my credit union.
Right.
I wish mm-hmm. at my credit union, in my credit union job, that I would have
had
known about this
mm-hmm.
and had this knowledge, because it tied out so well to just regular operations. Agile and Scrum do not have to be tech related.
Mm-hmm.
And what I found was looking at like, okay, every time I walk into a credit union to do a project, I'm like, all right, here's how I could use these ceremonies or these philosophies to improve their process.
Sure.
You know, make their lives a little bit easier.
Right.
And I also found myself doing things like this at home.
Good.
So
do you have stand-up meetings in the morning before school?
Well, not as much because I can't get my 9-year-old's attention for quite that long. 15 minutes is asking a lot of him. But a lot of the retrospective type of things.
Sure.
Like I find myself implementing. I have a college student. She's part of student government at the university. We do a lot of postmortems on what she's done as an official on her university campus.
Yeah.
My 9-year-old plays a lot of sports. We do the same thing. We look at like, well, what happened in the football game today?
What
could you do better next time? What can you do better at practice?
Good for you. It's great.
So it strangely found its way weaving into all of my life.
I love
it. And seeing how it applies, not just in tech, but really,
so do you go on dates and you're like, so let's talk about next time. I'm going to need flowers. And then.
No, but if I find myself forced to join the Tinder pool again, I will implement it.
I feel like Agile is perfect for Tinder. We shouldn't even have said that. We should have kept that off. So can you share with us like an action item or a takeaway or something that somebody could. I mean, you've already given us a few of them. Fail faster, the stand-up meetings.
Yep. I think if I have to pick one takeaway in Agile and Scrum that you can implement today to make an organization better, it is the retrospective. I think you take 30 minutes. Mm-hmm. It's kind of a great starting point. So you take 30 minutes to review whether something went really well or really, really terribly. And you identify those three topics. What went well or what did we do well? And you write them down. We love giant post-it notes at Prodigy. They're everywhere in our building.
Giant? What's
like
a giant?
The huge ones that like stick on the wall.
Okay.
Yeah, like the big flip chart size. You write what went well, what did not go well. And you have to be honest in those. Mm-hmm. If you're not honest, this will not work. What did not go well and what are we going to take into the next phase or the next week or the next day of our life to make this process better?
Awesome.
Close behind that would be the second, the 15-minute stand-up.
Yeah.
Really pulse checking with your team, your family, whatever it is that you're wanting to bring this mindset into to know where you're at every day. So.
And those can be applied in any way that is appropriate for the business, right? It doesn't have to be 15 minutes. It could be 5 if you have one employee, right?
Yes. Yeah.
You know,
exactly.
And the postmortem doesn't have to be a big production. It could be let's sit down and debrief what just occurred.
No, it should never. If you're implementing Scrum and you're starting with sort of the textbook recommendations, those two meetings should never exceed 15 minutes and 30 minutes.
That's smart. Yeah.
Because then you're just wasting time.
Yeah.
It's just no longer worthwhile at that point.
Right. It's really interesting that you say that, though, and I think it's so much, I relate it to a dog, like peeing on the carpet or something. Uh-huh. Like, you have to catch them in the moment somewhat, and I think so often we forget about that with human beings as well. Like, the more that you can do things in the moment, to debrief in the moment or right after, the better. Because so often I'll leave events and people say, okay, well, next week or in 3 weeks, we'll sit down and we'll talk about it. It, you know, so much gets lost.
Work.
Let's at least sit and just make a 1-minute list that we can then review in a week if you want to do that. But having that debrief or postmortem sounds like it could be really, really impactful.
Yeah, and it is important. I mentioned earlier, Agile's about being present and in the real time. Like, you can't delay those type of things or it's just not effective.
Yeah.
You forget everything that went good or bad at that point.
I mean, I forgot breakfast already.
Exactly. So it is important to be timely with those things too, but that really ties back to that being present and in the moment and aware of how your behaviors and your attitudes and your team's behaviors and attitudes are really impacting
the greater
organization.
I love it. So how could people get a hold of you if they wanted more information about Prodigy or about Agile?
Yeah, so the easiest way is probably email amber@cuprodigy.com. It's pretty easy. Also on Twitter, cuprodigyamber is the handle for my Twitter. If you socially kind of want to follow me, Instagram and Facebook. Like, I'm pretty much everywhere except, as mentioned, Tinder. You're not going to get a response.
She's like swiping left, just so you know. Well, thank you very much, Amber, for being here and shedding a light on Agile and how important it can be for not just technology organizations, but even leaders in their own lives and at home and that type of thing.
Yep.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Let's head out to our shout out.
Hi, I'm Simon. I'm studying management in Mexico City, and you're listening to Brandy's Strategic Hot Box.
So thank you again to Amber and kind of making it a bit more kind of tangible in my brain about what's happening with Agile and so many good tools, things that we have already potentially implemented in our business, but so many more things that we can be doing a little differently. And thank you, of course, to Simon, who I met in Mexico City and was studying management. And it was really cool to think about international students getting to study something that is a business philosophy or managed philosophy, but also studying it from a different perspective and being in a different country. So thank you to Simon for the shout outs, and keep those shout outs coming our way. We love to hear from all of you from all over the world. So now it's my favorite time. It's your favorite time. It's time to kick some ass. Number one for Agile is first to write in pencil. This has been my philosophy for, you know, as long as I can remember. I mean it very metaphorically, of course, because if you want to write in purple marker, then please feel free to write in purple marker. But metaphorically, write in pencil, because what can we do when we write in pencil? We can erase, right? And I think that that's what life requires, is us having the ability to erase, to rewrite, to write again, to do whatever we need to be flexible, to be nimble, to be agile, to be able to change plans in a second, to be able to take off running, whatever we have to do, because that's what reality takes. That's what life takes. And I know that any of you that are out there listening or watching know that things happen, life happens, and you want to make sure that the more that you can minimize any issues or challenges and keep the emotions out of it and write in pencil, erase it, switch it up, the better off that you'll be. Number two is, of course, being nimble, is being flexible. So more than just writing in pencil, being able to switch it up fast, it's also in your philosophy of being able to listen to other perspectives. I love the idea of not only having internal dialogue, but also having ongoing feedback and external dialogue as well. From an education or leadership standpoint, we will get a lot of external dialogue in the form of surveys or training feedback and things. But not often do you have as much ongoing dialogue throughout the process. We'll do in a strategic planning sense, sit down with the board chairman and throughout the day saying, is it going how we want to? Are we reaching those ideal outcomes? But if you think about it, that applies in any sort of side of business, to be able to be nimble and be flexible throughout the day, to know what's happening and making sure that you're working towards that goal. Number three, it's these are all just playing into each other, but engaging in that ongoing. And I really love this sense in the 360 perspective. So the external, the internal, but also up and down. How are we managing our bosses? How are we talking to our employees? How are we talking with one another? The idea that people are coming into it in a fearful stance and being able to maybe calm some of those fears. Or one of the things that Amber pointed out is, how can I help in providing the tools that I have and making their lives a little easier? How can I maybe calm a road block or remove a roadblock, or maybe just be abreast of the kinds of things that they're working on, so I know when to delegate, when not to delegate, and those kinds of things. And so that ongoing feedback just really kind of allows number one and number two to even happen. If you are talking the entire time, it allows you to be more nimble and allows us to write in pencil a little easier. Number four is to fail faster. Amber said it. I said it. We believe in it at Mitchell Stankovic and at the Strategic Hotbox. You have to fail faster, because that means you can succeed faster. And guarantee it, anybody that has achieved anything has failed so many times. There's so often that a friend or a colleague or a loved one will go through some sort of challenge or failure and have something. And I'll say to them, this is all part of your journey. It's time to get up. It's time to know that this failure was all part of it. Fail faster, stand up, and keep going, and make it happen. Because the faster that you fail, the faster you're back on track. And that's when you can get to the results that you want. And until you're focused and you're standing up, you're going after it again, what are you going to do? Just lay down on the ground and cry? Right? And that's, laying down on the ground and cry is not helping you achieve your goal. If I take it to a sense with my children, just really quickly, that a child the other day couldn't find a toy and they laid down on the ground and cried. And I thought to myself, and I said to them, is laying down on the ground right now, crying, helping you find that toy? No, it's not. And it seems so silly and trivial when we talk about it with a kid, but how often does that happen in business and in leadership and in life, right? When we found ourselves groveling, just, oh man, woe is me. I'm so sad and I'm a victim of this situation because I didn't get that promotion, or I didn't get that extra whatever. And you know, at the end of the day, no, you didn't. And now it's time to get up, fail faster, and get back on track and focus on those results. Number five is to simplify. One of the things about Agile that I learned in my research and we're learning from Amber is, although it's very complex, it also really does simplify. It kind of clears the slate saying, let's not make things really complex. Let's focus on what's important. Let's have dialogue. Let's be nimble. Let's re-engage with one another. Let's get to the failure so we also can roll things out a little quicker. Let's, you know, have some of these conversations so we get to market faster, so we create efficiencies, so we can have cost cutting, so we can have conversations with our clients. Because in the technology world, it's required. And in the leadership world, it's also becoming increasingly important. And so simplify. Life is complex enough. The more that you can simplify, the better. And there's your top five. Kick ass. So thank you again to Amber and to Simon for sending us the shout out. For those of you that are out there listening, if you want a topic that you want us to tackle here on the Hot Box, hit us up. Email us at podcast@strategichotbox.com, or similar to Amber, we're everywhere on social media. On Instagram and Twitter, we're at Brandy Love, or on Instagram at Strategic Hot Box. And then of course on Facebook, you can always reach us there at Strategic Hot Box. And for ongoing access to executive coaching tools. You've asked me for worksheets and different kind of things to get you started. We even put out there a leadership detox tool that you can download right now if you wanted to at thestrategichotbox.com. And so I just urge you to start doing something differently today. So until I see you again, get out there and kick some ass.